morning, friends, and welcome to our online service. We are getting to know Jesus through the Gospel of Luke. And we're in Luke chapter 4. We looked at Jesus, our high priest, Jesus, our prophet, and today, Jesus, our king. And so the main idea of this is Jesus meets our greatest need when we recognize him as the Son of God, God the Son, our Savior. We get to know Jesus best when we study the Bible, and if we want to know what God is like, then we look to Jesus. In Luke 4, we encounter Jesus, as I said, as priest, our high priest, as prophet and king, and specifically as king for the benefit of his people. And so 2 weeks ago, we started with this, looking at Jesus, high priest. Last week was Jesus, our prophet. And today we're looking at Jesus, our king, exercising his authority for our blessing. And so let's read Luke chapter 4, Luke chapter 4 from verse 28. And now, just prior to this, Jesus was in the synagogue. He opened the scroll of Isaiah, opened it to the place where for us would be chapter 61, read that part in Isaiah. And today this is fulfilled in your presence. And then he keep on speaking to them, mentioning Elijah, who went to the widow in Zarephath, speaking about Elisha, who went to Naaman the Syrian and healed him and not other people in Israel. And so then verse 28, when Jesus spoke these things about Elijah, been sent not necessarily to the many other widows in Israel, but to another widow, and the same with Elijah, not being sent to heal the people in Israel, but others. Then verse 28, we pick up, when they, and it's the people in the synagogue, when they heard these things, all in the synagogue were filled with wrath, and they rose up and drove him out of town, and brought him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they could throw him down the cliff. But passing through their midst, he went away. And he went down to Capernaum. And now just hang on there for a moment. In Capernaum, they also said, Jesus read their minds, and he said to them, "Oh, are you going to ask me now to perform those miracles that I did in Capernaum?" And you can read about that prior to verse 28, in verse 23, 24 onwards, and it seems like these people were looking for all the many signs and wonders and miracles that Jesus did in Capernaum. But now they want to throw Jesus off the cliff. But then verse 31, he went back through them, and he went down to Capernaum, a city in Galilee, and he was teaching them on the Sabbath, and they were astonished at his teaching, for his words possessed authority. And in the synagogue there was a man who had a spirit of an unclean demon, and he cried out with a loud voice, "Ha! What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And when the demon had thrown him down in their midst, he came out of him, having done him no harm. And they were all amazed and said to one another, "What is this word? For with authority and power he commands the unclean spirits, and they came out." And reports about him went out into every place in the surrounding region. And he rose and left the synagogue and entered Simon's house. Now Simon's mother-in-law was ill with a high fever, and they appealed to him on her behalf. And he stood over her and rebuked the fever, and it left her, and immediately she rose and began to serve them. Now when the sun was setting, all those who had any who were sick with various diseases brought them to him, and he laid his hands on every one of them and healed them. And demons also came out of many, crying, "You are the Son of God." But he rebuked them and would not allow them to speak, because they knew that he was the Christ. And when it was day, he departed and went into a desolate place. And the people sought him and came to him, and would have kept him from leaving. But he said to them, "I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God to other towns as well, for I was sent for this purpose." and he was preaching in the synagogues of Judea. And so, friends, in verse 28 to 29, we see here that the Israelites rejected Jesus. And ironically, the people tried to put Jesus in the same position that Satan tried to tempt Jesus with earlier on in chapter 4 by throwing Jesus down from a cliff, down from a height. But then instead, the people getting a miracle, but not like the miracle that they were looking for that Jesus performed in Capernaum. No, they get this miracle because imagine for a moment, there must have been at least 10 people, at least 10, but definitely more than that, taking Jesus to the cliff. They're standing there, they want to throw Jesus down the cliff, but then suddenly, miraculously, Jesus turned around and he walked right through them without them being able to even lay a hand on them. Just showing again that Jesus is absolutely in control. He's ruling and reigning sovereignly. And the time for his crucifixion have not yet arrived. And so Jesus did not do the miracles, the ones that they wanted. But he did another miracle. He passed right through them unharmed. Can you imagine the people's faces when they wonder what had just happened now? Now, Jesus never said a word, and as far as we know, he never returned to his hometown, Nazareth. And then he went to Capernaum. And as far as we know that Jesus never went back to Nazareth, that kind of gives us an indication that some rejections are final. They rejected Jesus there, he went away, and he never probably went back there. Now, if you do not trust and follow Jesus as Lord and Savior, may I say to you, maybe you want him to entertain you with miracles and satisfy your unbelief, maybe like these people wanted. But no, rather take Jesus at his word. He was speaking to them. And they did not want to take Jesus at his word in the synagogue, and they wanted him to do miracles. But would you take Jesus at his word that he is who he says he is? Believe his teaching. Trust him today. Make a decision to trust Jesus and to follow him as the only Lord and Savior, and surrender your life to him. Do not reject him. Do not reject him like the people here in Nazareth rejected him. Or he may reject you in the end. And that rejection will be final. It will be a final rejection with eternal consequences. You see, there's a window of opportunity that you have still. Even if you're here today, there's a window of opportunity not to reject Jesus, but to turn to him, to go to him and to trust him for the forgiveness of your sins and to follow him as the only Lord and Savior of your life. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ so that you may be saved and have eternal life. Now, following the people's rejection in Nazareth, Jesus now moves to Capernaum. Now, a town where Simon Peter lived with his family and here at Capernaum, and we see Jesus reveals more about his identity as God the Son. Jesus repeatedly in the Gospel of Luke demonstrates that as God the Son, he has authority over all things. Jesus is the King of Kings, the only King with absolute authority over everything of his creation. And now we come to Luke 4, verse 28 to 44, and here in this part that we just read, we encounter Jesus as God the Son with absolute authority, and specifically in three domains. Authority in his teaching, authority over demons, and authority over physical existence. So Jesus' authority in his teaching. If you go back to Matthew, and in Matthew chapter 7, right at the end of chapter 7, verse 28 and verse 29. Now you need to start reading from Matthew chapter 5, because Matthew 7 verse 28 says the following: "And when Jesus finished teaching these sayings," what sayings? Well, here's Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. You start reading from chapter 5. You read right up until the end of chapter 7. And then it says, when Jesus finished teaching these things, the crowds were astonished at his teaching. For he was teaching them as one who had authority and not as their scribes. Jesus was not like the Pharisees. He was not like the scribes who actually taught with a lot of speculation and doubt. Now Jesus, on the other hand, he was not teaching with question marks. He was teaching with exclamation marks and with power. There was this confidence and authority in his message. When Jesus spoke, the people were cut to the heart. There was something about him. And even here in Luke 4, the people were astonished and amazed at his words. But even then, still, some rejected him and some still did not want to believe that Jesus is who he says he is. So when Jesus taught with authority, and specifically the Old Testament, it is as if he was saying to them and teaching them with such an authority that this Old Testament is his autobiography. Because everything points to him. Everything in the Old Testament is about him. Right at the end of Luke, when Jesus, after his resurrection, appeared to the disciples, he said to them, you know, everything in the law, in the first 5 books of the Bible, and in the Psalms, and in the prophets, they all point to Jesus Christ. And everything is about him. Remember, in their days, they did not have the Bible like we have it today, but they only had the first 5 books of the Bible and the Psalms and the prophets. But Jesus taught with authority, and when he taught from the Old Testament, it was as if they experienced almost like, but this is Jesus' autobiography. This is about him. The religious people were amazed. When Jesus preached, their hearts responded, because they never heard a teacher like Jesus with such authority in his teaching. Then secondly, Jesus' absolute authority over demons. In verse 33, you see, in the synagogue there was a man who had a spirit of an unclean demon. Now you run into the devil in the most surprising of places, so to speak. You probably don't expect to find a demon-possessed person in a synagogue or in a church. Now Satan took hold of a man, and Satan took this man to church, because Satan loved to oppose Jesus' work. Right there where the Lord is meant to be worshipped and to be adored as the one and only Savior, he comes and he wants to oppose the Lord's work. Here's this man, he's screaming in church, and the religious people and the leaders, they had no answer. But then with a command, with a stern command, Jesus ruled over this evil spirit. And we find that in verse 35, Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of the man." And so we see that Jesus has the power and the authority to control even the forces of darkness, to command Satan and his demons. They are under the absolute authority of Jesus. And now a demon is a fallen angel who rebelled with Satan against God and was casted from heaven. And these demons are committed to oppose God's rule and everything that God does. They hate God and they hate Christ followers. They hate the church. And the biggest mistake that we can do as Christ followers is to be on this one end of the spectrum to say, oh, well, it's just old wives' tales. No, there's no such thing as the devil and his demons. No, that is the lie that the devil wants you to believe. And on the other extreme of the of this continuum, we do not want to be like kind of Ghostbusters and look and find a demon behind every bush. But let us pray for discernment. Let us pray that God will help us and see that there is a spiritual battle. Paul writes to the church in Ephesus, and he says our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against the devil and his dark evil forces. And so here we find when Jesus speaks, demons tremble. Here we encounter Jesus, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, with all authority in heaven and on earth. And Jesus always wins. He wins, he rules even over the demonic forces. And even they proclaim and even they understand who Jesus is. So he's got authority in his teaching. He's got absolute authority over demons. And then Jesus has authority over physical existence. Verse 38 to verse 40, Jesus in Simon Peter's house. Jesus demonstrates his authority over physical existence primarily through healing. Jesus heals Peter's mother-in-law. Now, fevers don't have ears or minds, but Jesus speaks to this virus or this whatever this thing is causing the sickness. And yes, it might be a demonic influence or it might not be. Not every sickness is influenced and caused by a demon. So once again, let's not fall into that extreme category. But whatever is causing the sickness and causing this fever, Jesus speaks and this obeys Jesus. What power does Jesus exercise? Immediately she was healed. Immediately she stood up as she was never sick. And she prepared them a meal. Then in verse 40 onwards, we read that Jesus heals many other diseases. He healed everyone. He didn't turn anyone away. He didn't turn the difficult cases away. He didn't sell tickets or ask for an offering. The people, the sick were brought. He healed them. And many times he went to them. So when Jesus heals, there is no faking. There's no faking. And we should also keep in mind that Satan always counterfeits. Yes, there are many other counterfeit miracles. We even see in Acts 8, we see Simon the sorcerer who did many signs and wonders. There are counterfeit miracles that Satan can do. And we need to pray for discernment that God will help us. We need to understand that Jesus is the real deal. He is God the Son. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He has authority in his teaching, authority over demonic powers, and authority over physical existence. And yes, the way that Jesus healed here was unique, and it was confirming the fact that he is God the Son. But Jesus has also given us authority, and we go in his authority. And his Bible, his written word, commands us and instructs us also to pray for the sick and to lay hands on the sick and to move out and to go. When last did you go to a hospital and to go and pray for the sick there? How many people just have healing meetings? What about going into hospitals and going to pray? Yes, we do not always fully, completely understand, but God remains sovereign. It is his sovereign will. Ultimately, the bottom line, it is his sovereign will in healing. We see some are healed and some are not. Because the kingdom of God is about the now and the not yet. We are yet to experience the fullness, the complete fullness of God's kingdom when Jesus returns. But in the meantime, we are obedient, we trust Jesus, we move out, and let us go and exercise our faith and our trust and our authority in Jesus. And yes, let's go and pray for the sick at every opportunity we have. Now in this text as well, who understands the truth about Jesus? The demons. They cried out. I know who you are, they said in verse 34. I know who you are, the Holy One of God. And the Holy One of God is just another way of saying, but you are Jesus the Messiah. You are the Savior. You are God the Son. And so the same way that we saw earlier in chapter 4, that the devil knows the Bible, and he quoted Psalm 91 to Jesus, that the demons, they know who Jesus are, but they do not obey him, they rebel against him, they do not acknowledge him as God and Lord and Savior and bow before him and surrender to him. No, in rebellion and disobedience, they were cast out of heaven, but they know who Jesus are. So we read in James even, it says, but the devil knows who Jesus are. You know, they believe in Jesus, but not like we as Christ followers. They don't believe in Jesus in a saving faith, but they know who Jesus are. They know the truth about Jesus. But then interesting enough, we also see these demons know that their days are numbered. Their days are numbered. Have you come to destroy us in verse 34? they know that they have limited time to continue in their wickedness and their attack against Jesus and his Christ followers. They know their time is limited. They know there comes a day when Jesus returns, and then it says in Revelation that the devil and all his demons and all those who follow him and who rejected Jesus will be cast into the eternal lake of fire. They know their time are limited. And once again, friends, we have a limited time of opportunity. Do not reject Jesus in your limited time of opportunity, but make a decision to come to him. He is God the Son. He alone got the authority to forgive our sins, to cleanse us, to dress us, so to speak, in his righteousness, in his holiness, that we can stand accepted in Jesus Christ, in his person and his finished work on the cross, where he died in your place for your sins. And on the third day, we bodily rose from the dead for our justification, so that we can be reconciled with our Creator God. Now, even as the demons know that their days are limited, the days of man's sinful rebellion against God are also numbered. You have the opportunity to either continue in rebellion or by repenting of your sin and turning to Jesus. Because he is the righteous judge. He will come in his holiness, and he will come as the righteous judge. Paul even reminds Timothy of that. In Timothy chapter 4, he says, he is the righteous judge who will judge justly. Jesus, when he returns, he will demonstrate his holiness and his just judgment. And there will be no turning. There will be no turning away. There will be no opportunity to turn to him when Jesus returns. But there's an opportunity today to come to Jesus, to acknowledge him, that he is who he says he is. He is God the Son. Receive forgiveness. Follow him. Put your trust and hope in him, the living one. Come to Jesus while there is an opportunity. Recognize him. Trust him as God the Son. Receive forgiveness for your sins. Now, if you are a Christ follower, the application for you and me here is look how loud the demons proclaim, Jesus, you are the Holy One of God. You are the Holy One. They proclaim Jesus. Now, the question is, do we acknowledge Jesus as loudly as even the demons does? Do we obey? Just consider how the demons obey Jesus. Are we more quicker and more joyful in our obedience to Jesus than demons? How much more shall we, who have been loved unconditionally by Jesus, who have been chosen by Jesus, who have received forgiveness by Jesus, who have been brought into God's family, who have been called sons and daughters of the Most High, how much more shall we show our love towards Jesus in quick and joyful obedience? Let us not allow demons to be more obedient to Jesus than us. Let us not allow them to acknowledge and proclaim or to acknowledge Jesus more loudly than what we proclaim Jesus to be, the only God and Savior. And so, friends, in conclusion, Jesus, who has authority over everything, is our Messiah, our Savior, who loves you. Trust him. Place your hope in him, your full hope in him. He is our High Priest. He is our Prophet. He is our King with absolute authority. Lord Jesus, thank you that we can come to you today as our King. Our King who rule and reign with absolute authority. And you reign with absolute authority for our blessing. Lord, the good things, the things that we receive on this temporary earth, thank you when your kingdom breaks through into our lives and we have a foretaste of eternity. We have a foretaste of your eternal kingdom and the fullness of your kingdom to come and to be experienced when you return, Lord Jesus. Thank you that we can trust you. Thank you for your final absolute authority in your teaching. Thank you for your authority that you have over all of creation. Yes, Lord, even over demonic forces and power, over our physical existence, over sickness. Thank you that we can trust you for healing. But thank you that we also know that there will be ultimate, complete, full healing when you return and we receive our glorified, resurrected bodies. Holy Spirit, help us to continue steadfast, faithfully, as we follow and our Lord and our Savior and our King, Jesus Christ, as we continue to pledge our full allegiance to the King of Kings, Jesus Christ. We pray that in your wonderful name, Lord. Amen. Friends, be blessed. Next week we continue to get to know Jesus through the Gospel of Luke.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Saved a wretch like me. For I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Welcomed home, the sinner now a saint. But the God who died came back to life, and everything is changed. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Oh, death, where is your sting? Your open arms, the beauty of your face. Through tears of joy, I lift my voice in everlasting praise.
Eternal life is ours.
And on the day you call me in to heaven's sweet embrace, I see your scars, your open arms, the beauty of your face. Through tears of joy I lift my voice in everlasting praise. Hallelujah, Christ is risen from the grave.